Yes, I would like to set the scene in the next coming minutes, trying to address some of the buzzwords we have included in the program of the conference. So I will first try to give a definition, or at least my definition of convergence, and then look into practical examples of what can be called disintermediation. So we see convergence as, at least at the first point, as first a technical process, basically. If we look back at what happened in the 90s, you remember there was a lot of buzz about convergence already 15 years ago. It was basically a process where networks providing television services, were offering, okay, thanks. In case there was any doubt. Yeah. there obviously was. In the 90s, the traditional cable television networks and the telecommunication networks start proposing increasingly similar functionalities, basically, meaning that the cable networks started to offer telecom services, internet access, and the telecom networks also started to offer television services. So there was a convergence of the functionalities of the television network, and this led to a first phase of a model of vertical integration, where telecom networks were also providing, distributing television services. If we, for this conference, ask convergence again, it's because we feel that a similar process is happening, but this time between the open internet and the managed television network. Because we feel that the open internet, on the one side, and the networks which are dedicated to the transmission of television increasingly offer similar functionalities. So that there is a convergence between the open internet and, namely, cable networks and telecom networks providing television services. On the open internet, it started with download of video, so we went on to streaming on video. It went on to the simulcast of live television channels, and even now to the distribution of package of television channels on the open internet. So that's what we call convergence, similar functionalities between the open internet and classical television network. And the consequences to be discussed today are, in our view, that it opens the competition with new players, and that it may cause a reorganization of the value chain. So again, convergence, as in more possibility to broadcast television channel, more possibility to offer on-demand services. With the convergence between the open internet and the managed television networks come a series of additional changes. First, the new quality of service on the internet enables to distribute services directly, not only to the PC, but also to the TV sets. To us, it's a first point of discussion. It seems to be possible to distribute audiovisual service bypassing the role of packager of the telecom operator or of the cable operator. The open internet also brings new IT development, the possibility to more easily handle advertisement and also more easily understand what exactly the consumer wants. At the same time, some other phenomena are happening. The most important one is the question about usages, meaning the new needs or requirement of consumer to more directly pick up the programs that they want to look at, so maybe opt for programs rather than for TV channels. And also at the same time, another point of context, the fact that the markets, the traditional television markets, are more in the stagnation phase, which can push some of the players to grab part of the revenues of other players in the value chain. So that's how we see the context. Possibility to go directly to the consumer, new needs for on-demand consumption, and an incentive to grab part of the revenues of the intermediaries. So in that context, let's look at disintermediation, and to start with, let's look at the value chain of the distribution of audiovisual programs. And this is a simplified value chain, and it's complex. Complex doesn't mean inefficient, it's just that it is complex. Producers produce programs, and even within the producer blocks, a lot can be said between designing the programs, writing the topic, financing them, so that's already a very complex block. Then the rights are handed to a distributor, rights are sold to an audiovisual services, a service, a TV channel, an on-demand service. If we have a bundle of TV services, there is a packager who bundles a package of TV channels. The package is distributed over a transmission network, could be cable, could be telco, and then goes to the consumer. So it's a complex value chain with many, many steps. And that's probably due to the many steps in the value chain that the question of disintermediation or simplification of the value chain takes place. To be less theoretical, let me give you some examples. And I'm going to be clear about this. These are examples of possible disintermediation. We are not saying at the observatory that there is a massive trend toward disintermediation right now. We are saying that some phenomenon, as Suzanne put it out, can be observed. We are not saying that we are in a situation where disintermediation is the massive trend on the market. So let me give some examples. The first example is the role of TV broadcasters themselves and whether the consumer doesn't need anymore a TV channel. The theory would be that rather than picking up between television channels, the consumer would go directly to an on-demand service, and that would threaten the traditional way of a broadcaster to package the TV programs within a TV channel. Here we can give some figures on that, and they are on this slide. And that's a comparison between the role of the traditional pay TV model, the bundle of TV channels, and the on-demand consumption. And that these are figures for Europe. And what it shows is that even if the on-demand part of the market is growing faster than the pay TV traditional part of the market, the on-demand part still remains very small when compared with the traditional pay TV part. Of interest is also the fact that so far, at least in Europe, the growth of on-demand does not translate in Europe, at least, into a decrease of the traditional pay TV model. Maybe this we can discuss later on the panel. A second possible disintermediation is the role of the packager itself. You remember in the value chain, you are a TV channel, and then you go to a TV packager, and often the TV packager is the manager of the transmission network, the telco company or the cable company. With internet, you can have a system of direct distribution, meaning that you can go directly to the subscriber without going through a packager. So that can be called self-distribution, and it changes the nature of the company who had the relationship with the customer. In the classical system, the relationship with the customer is maintained by the cable operator or by the telco. In the direct distribution, it's maintained directly by the service itself. This system applies to on-demand. It also applies to TV channels, which can be distributed directly to the consumer. My third example is about distributing film to on-demand services. This is a classical value chain for the exploitation of film. Again, it's oversimplified, but it's still based on the fact that a producer sells all his rights for film, for cinemas, I'm sorry, for DVD, for VOD, and for TV to a national distributor who, in turn, exploits all the rights and, in particular, goes to VOD. One example of this intermediation would be what we could call the holdback of VOD rights, meaning that the VOD, the producer, on the left side of the slide, does not bundle anymore the VOD rights within what he's selling to the national distributor. And instead of giving his VOD rights to the national distributor, in that scheme, the producers try to go directly to the VOD service, which is a threat for the national distributor, which remains in charge of theatrical exploitation, in charge of DVD and in charge of TV, but no longer of VOD. So the national distributor in that scheme is disintermediated. And my two last examples. One about sports. It has been a long discussion whether we would see someday the sports right holder, the sports federation, going directly to the consumer, meaning not selling them the rights for the big sports events directly to the broadcaster, but selling them directly to the consumers. You can see some examples of this. Again, sports federation going directly to the consumer, but there are very limited examples. Some niche sports service, for example, if you are absolutely fond of US basketball, you could, in Europe, subscribe to a service directly offered by the National Basketball Association from the US without going through a European TV channel. But of course, that's a very niche product in Europe. Some other less popular championships are available for free on the internet because no broadcaster was interested in getting the rights. And just again, as a minor example, we saw during the last Euro 16 that some of the games were not bought by broadcasters and therefore they were made available online for free directly by the UEFA because there was no broadcaster interested. So we saw some moderate, small example of direct-to-consumer strategies from sport organizations, but these remain still pretty limited. And here again, the broadcasters are the players which are disintermediated. My last example is about how is advertising by TV channel or on TV channel managed online. As far as the traditional television advertising is concerned, there is a direct relationship between the TV channel and the advertiser. As regards the online advertising on TV channels, the scheme is really different because TV channels tend to place or give their advertising inventory to third-party platforms, which in turn, as shown on these schemes, this advertising is sold automatically to the advertising without a direct relationship between the television channel and the advertisers. So in that scheme, which is a pretty automated scheme, sometimes called programmatic advertising, the direct relationship between the television channel and its ad house and the advertising, the advertisers or the agencies is broken. There is no longer a direct relationship between them. So these are very different examples of possible disintermediation, I'm not, of course, and that we'll discuss later on, saying that there are no new intermediaries in the value chains, but certainly example where the traditional links between players are broken. And I would just like to introduce one last buzzword, because it's sometimes addressed as it were the same thing that disintermediation, and in our view it's a very different phenomenon, but which is important. I'm sorry, before that I would like to put out two impacts. I'm sorry, Maya, 1 minute. 1 minute and I'm done. Okay. Possible impacts of disintermediation. Okay. Again, theory, if there are less intermediaries, there can be profits or benefits at both ends of the value chain. Okay. Meaning what? Benefits from the consumer point of view, lower price services, and maybe benefits also from the producer point of view. And some estimates, and these are figures from the US market, show that when you have a self-distribution process, bypassing the intermediaries, you can have at the same time lower prices for the consumer and a higher share of revenues getting back to the producers. And the second impact is probably that if the value chain is at stake, content and the control of content is even more important than it used to be. And what this slide shows is that basically TV channels, maybe because their role of packager was at stake, have started reinvesting a lot of production and are among the strongest content producers today in Europe. And here I come to my final buzzword, which is uberization. As I was saying, to us, it's a very different concept than the one of disintermediation. What is uberization in other industries? It's basically the use of unused resources. You know, beds, in the case of Airbnb, car seats, in the case of Uber. And these unused resources are sold on a peer-to-peer basis to individual consumers. That's not what applies to most of the on-demand services here, because the differences are that there is an investment in content for on-demand services, whereas Uber doesn't invest in cars, whereas Airbnb doesn't invest in beds, as far as I understand. So it's a different phenomenon. We do not believe it applies to the on-demand audiovisual services. It may more apply to a very different nature of services. Probably the video sharing platform are more of a relevant example of an uberization process in the audiovisual industry. And with this, I conclude. Thank you for your attention. Sorry for being a little bit too long. Thanks.